So today I'm going to discuss about, it means, I think you have worked with service mesh and microservices. I think all of you have worked with those stuff, right? So after microservices come into the picture, what people thought of, there's no requirement of API management in this around these use cases. So basically today what I'm going to discuss about, why still we need API management even though there are service mesh and microservice architecture, how we are going to use API manager there. So if I go through the agenda today, I'll discuss about the how the application evolved, then I discuss why microservice architecture is required, then I'll go through the challenges that we face while we are working on the microservices, then why we need service mesh and how service mesh is going to solve the challenges we face with the microservices. Then I'll do a simple demo to expose of one service connecting with the Istio. Then I'll discuss the today's main topic, why we need API management even though we have service mesh in place. Then I'll discuss how WSO to API manager integrate with Istio, and then I'll do a quick demo integrating WSO to API manager with Istio and show that those capabilities. So to start with, so you know, over the last, let's say, 5 decades, the application evolved. It moved into the disaggregated architecture. Let's say we came into the disaggregated architecture because there are industry demands. So we have to deliver, let's say, our business capabilities very soon to the outside. So due to that reason, as a solution, this disaggregated architecture became popular. So in that case, we can very easily bring our functionalities to the outside. So that's the advantage of this disaggregated architecture. So nowadays, serverless, microservices, APIs are become known when developing applications with disaggregated architecture. So let's see how the microservices and the monolith services are getting different. So yes, there's monolith services, the microservice, in between that we have the service-oriented architecture as well. So the main difference is in the monolith you have one application, so that application may have several functionalities. So if you think about the CRM system, there are hundreds of functionalities you need to expose. So all will be in a single application. So if there is a high demand for a given functionality, there's no way to scale it up, right? At the same time, even if you want to improve one segment of that application, you have to work on the whole application. So later that service-oriented architecture came, there you can develop the component basis, but still the within a one application, those all the components will reside. So it means one process was running. When it comes to the deployment time, again we have all the challenges that we face with monolith application. Then the microservice architecture, so we can say it's kind of doing the SOA in the correct way. So each business functionality will run in a different process. So there can be a different team working on that given business functionality. So they can manage their own delivery life cycles, and if we need to scale that up easily, that component can be scaled up, right? So at the same time, each business component may require different technology. So if someone is like to use a different technology, that team can use another technology, and another team can use a different technology. Likewise, they can develop their component in a different way, in the way that that team preferred to implement. So those are the kind of advantages we see with this microservice architecture. So if we closely look at this microservice architecture, so it means for the outside it can be a one application, but internally there are several components. So if it's a small application, there can be very few number of components, so there's no issue in managing those components, right? So, but in reality, if you build a the business level application, there should be many functionalities, which means there are many number of components or the microservices, different processes. So managing the huge number of microservices is not easy. And the main challenges face is the communication, right? So those are communicating over the network. So how to manage these number of services and how to manage those communications? Likewise, there are several challenges we are facing in microservice architecture. So let's see what are the other challenges that we face. Then we can see how service mesh come into picture and help to solve this problem. The first challenge is resilience, right? So we know we have set of processors running individually. So those are communicating over the network. So networks are not 100% reliable, even it's a local network. So, but we build a reliable application on top of unreliable network. So we have to handle those challenges. So when we talk to service to service, that call may be timeout, or one call can fail. And sometimes in different levels, it may add latencies, and altogether in another layer, it can get failed. So it's kind of a challenge. So we have to implement some other ways to handle that thing, some kind of circuit breaking, or we have to retry if something fail. Likewise, it is a new API, right? Then it can be a new service, and due to this immutable nature of these nodes, it will bring up with a new IP address. So let's say one service used to communicate with the previous API. So at that time, the first service may know where the second service resides. But what happened, they roll out the existing service and bring a new one. Then we can't hard code, or we can't rely that this service may run in this place, right? So we have to handle that thing. We should have a way to discover the other microservices, where they reside and what are the endpoints. We have to get that information. That's another challenge we face when we are dealing with the microservices. Then the next challenge is the security. In the microservice, we are communicating with each service through the network. So we have to secure each communication. Right? So when if we have different components managed by different teams, each team has to think about how they secure this communication, how they handle that authentication, the service-to-service communication and their related security. At the same time, they might have developed these microservices using different technologies. In that case, those technologies may have different ways to handle the security. So they have to think of that. Sometimes some technology may not handle a given protocol. Let's say we are going to use JWT to do the communication and do the authentication. In that case, one language may do support to validate the JWT easily. There can be a library for that. But in the another language that you are trying to use may not support that thing. Then you will have to write it from the scratch. So those are the challenges we face in the security phase. So if you have questions, you can ask, right? Is it clear, right? What I'm good. Then the observability, then another challenge. So if you think about the monolith application, you have one application, you know where to implement the login, how to trace it, how to get the metrics, all you know because you have only a single application. But when it comes to the microservice architecture, each component resides in different places. So each component level, you have to do the login, you have to do the tracing and other metrics. And at the same time, we have to collect those information to a single place and have to process. So you have to think those aspects.
Then again, we talk that all the time that each team can release their own component at any time they prefer, right? So in that case, how do they roll out? So if something happens, they have to roll back whatever the version they release. So we have to manage those things as well. So how we are going to solve this problem? So that's the place where service mesh came into picture. So the service mesh is a dedicated infrastructure layer that control all of these challenges. So the whatever the microservice developers, they do not need to worry about these challenges. They can directly go and implement their business functions. So the service mesh is going to handle the other challenges that we discuss. In the service mesh, sidecar is a very important, I think. Do you all know about sidecars? I think you know, right? So sidecar is a proxy kind of component which reside with the service, right? So the sidecar handle the all the complexities. The actual microservice only do whatever the business function it requires. So with the sidecar concept is used in the service mesh. So if you see in this picture, in the green color we have all the service. They don't know about any other service and how they work, but the proxies reside with each of these microservice handle this capability. So if we take all of these proxies together, it helps to build the service mesh. Okay. In a service mesh, we can divide it into two parts. One is called the data plane, and the second thing is called the control plane. So the data plane is the actual the proxy services which intercept these messages, and it handle all of these, let's say the communication challenges or the security, all the things handled by the actual the proxy service. Though this set of proxy services are called as the data plane. So having only this proxy service doesn't handle our requirement. So now again we have the challenge, how we manage this proxy service, how we define the proxy service, and how we define the policies, how to handle this request, and how we push these policies into this each proxy service. To do that thing, we should have some kind of control plane. So when we have this control plane and data plane together, we call it as a service mesh. So Istio is a open source service mesh implementation. So basically Istio is mainly represent this control plane. For the data plane, it used the envoy proxy. So Istio is implemented on top of the envoy proxy, and there are another service mesh implementations as well, like smart stack, like that. So but Istio is the most common service mesh implementation we have at the moment. So if you look at the Istio, there are several components. So first we have the proxies which represent the data plane. Actually those are the envoy proxies. Then the actual Istio, which consists of this data plane, it has let's say four main components. One is the mixer, that the part which push the policies into the proxies, and how the policy evaluation happened, those are decided through the proxy. And this is kind of this has a kind of pluggable architecture, so you can write your own component and put it there. So this is the extension point we use to plug Istio into the WC2 API manager. So then we have the Citadel, where it controls the credentials and the certificate in this service mesh. And we have the pilot, it manages all the how the traffic moves, especially the circuit breaking, service discovery. Everything will be handled through the pilot, and gallery is kind of a component which handles all the policies and this integration. Okay, I'll do a quick demo. I use the simple service, which is simple service, and I'll expose it to configuring Istio. So if you have used Istio previously, anyone used Istio? Yes, then you might have used this sample. So I'll just show you that thing. So I'm not going to discuss more about the Istio and how it works, but I'll later go and discuss how to configure, connect API manager with Istio and how it is. Okay. I am running all these components on top of the GKE, so there I have installed the Istio. You can see there are Istio related components are installed. So now I am going to install the services, the HTTP bin sample. I think you might have used that thing. So I'll install that thing and expose that. Okay. So first I'll deploy the HTTP bin sample, then I'll expose it via the ingress gateway. Okay. So with this command, so whatever the stuff I do here, there's a Git project, so later you can go and try it out. So I'll just go through these commands and show how it works, so later you can try it out. So first I'll deploy the HTTP bin sample. Then I'll try to expose it outside to the ingress gateway. So don't worry about these commands and anything. So when you try the sample, you can see it. So it seems the services are created and it is exposed to the outside. So we need to find the IP address and the other stuff to connect. So let's find it and try to get that response first.
So here what I found is this is the IP address which exposed to the outside, and this is the port.
Yes.
So with this port and the IP address, I'll talk to the service and get the response. So now I got the response from the microservice I have already installed. So don't worry that much about this response and how it's deployed. So later I'm trying to secure this service and manage this service via the API manager. So I'll more discuss in that part. So now the main topic that we are going to discuss today. So if we have a service mesh, why we need to API management? So let's first see the difference between the service mesh and the API management solution. So the first thing is the API, the routing happened in service mesh in layer 3 or the layer 7. In the API manager, it in the layer 7 application layer, it can be HTTP, gRPC or GraphSQL in that layer. And in the service mesh, especially that in the security perspective, this service to service authentication is the main thing. And in the API management layer, it has the concept of the application and it uses the users. So in the service mesh layer, we don't have this the user concept or the application concept. So that only comes with the API manager. Then in the analytics, in the service mesh, we just analyze the service operation related analytics. But when it comes to the actual business, we need to get the information about our actual API. Who are the people going to use that thing? How many people going to use that thing? Like that, the real business related information should be gathered. So that's another requirement of the API management solution. And the rate limiting, so that rate limiting also mainly focus on the service layer, but in the API management solution we have to focus about the business related stuff. So and when it comes to service mesh, again developers will involve in that layer. So they develop individual services and they will expose those services via the service mesh. So after exposing these different kind of services, eventually as an organization there are a set of APIs which are exposed to the outside. So now it's very similar to the things what you are doing at the moment. So regardless of its microservice architecture or the monolith architecture, you have a set of business APIs. You have exposed those APIs outside to the world. Now we have the business requirement. So we need to let people to come and find these APIs, right? The public APIs. We want them to subscribe those APIs and consume those APIs. Once they try to consume, we have to gather the stats and see how these people are using. And if they are using, we need to provide the proper security for these people. And we need to guarantee all the authentic users only accessing these API which are exposed to the outside. So
This is the primary requirement of an API management solution, which is not covered with the service mesh. So we can clearly see service mesh is addressing a different problem, and the API management solution is addressing a different problem. But to build a business application, we have to combine these two. We should have the APIs. At the same time, we have to expose these APIs and manage these APIs. So this is the place where API management come into picture, even though we have a service mesh in place. Yes. So these are the occasions we need service mesh. So when user need to expose microservice to the outside in a secure and controlled manner, we need to have API management solution, because in the microservice we don't have the concept called user, so then we can't do the user authentication, so we have to bring another layer. So that is the API manager. Then we need to enforce the fine-grained security to the API. So if you, I think at the moment also you may be using OAuth2 to secure the API. You may use scopes to define different business capabilities. So we need to bring it into the picture. So API manager will do that. When we need to gather the information about the business usage, yes, we have to use the API manager. Especially we need to have a place where people come and discover this API, kind of a marketplace. So if you are not trying to use API management solution, from the scratch you have to write something like that, right? So even if you write, it will become another API management solution. So you can use whatever the existing API management solution to cater that requirement. Okay, so far, do you have any questions? No, good. So WSO2 API, so for this demonstration and other purpose, I use the WSO2 API manager. So if you read WSO2 API manager, also a leading API management solution in the Gartner reports, we are recognized as one of the leader in API management solutions. So I'll use WSO2 API manager for this. So first, this is the architecture, how we expose service through the ingress gateway and configuring the Istio. So as I said earlier, we have the data plane where the actual message interception and business functionality is executing. Then we have the control plane where we control this service mesh. So there you can see all the components. So mixture is there. So when requests come into the service, the way when someone tries to invoke the service exposed by service A, first it will come to the envoy proxy. Then it will talk to the mixture and see whether there is an applicable policy. And if there is an applicable policy, it will be evaluated within the proxy. Then it will let that request go into the actual service. If something happened, or it means if the validation failed, it will send an error message back. So this is mixture is the place where we plug WSO2 API manager. So we have written adapter, extended component, where we connect mixer or the service mesh into the API manager. So API manager will do the API publishing part, and when you publish the API, there you can define the security levels, scopes related to that API and everything. Then this API manager will push that policy into the mixer. So later when the request come into the service, those policies will be evaluated. And we have the WSO2 API store, which kind of a marketplace for the outside people who want to find out those APIs. They can come to the API store and discover the API. At the same time, we have API analytics, where you can see the business related analytics, right? So this is how API manage. Then again, another component is not shown here, that is the key manager or the token issuer, where you get the token. So basically, when you try to invoke the service, first you come to the API management layer and discover the whatever the available API. Then you subscribe to the whatever the API you want to implement your client. Once you subscribe, you will get a consumer key and the secret in the default auth flow. Then you should get a token from this API management solution. With that token, you will try to invoke the service that is exposed through the service mesh. Then in the proxy layer, it will talk to the mixer and see if there's applicable policy. So if we have defined the, if we have published the API saying this is secured, so these are the scopes that should be validated when we invoke, then that information will be available in the mixer. So based on the policy, that will be validated. So in the current this adapter implementation, we do support for two type of authentication. One is the normal OAuth2 token, bearer tokens. Then the second thing is the JWT token. So later I'll discuss how these are validated. Yes, now I'll show you. Okay, sorry. Yes, cool. There we use the ingress gateway. Yes, true. Yes. So in the normal API, it means there are two ways, right? One thing, yes, actually there are two ways API manager bring into this picture. One is we are not going to use the ingress gateway. Instead, you can directly use the API gateway and it will be fronted from the all the APIs, right? That's the one way. And the second way is use the inbuilt gateway, and it is use the gateway of the API manager. So there are two patterns actually.
You are correct.
So in this scenario, we are not using the actual gateway component. So there's no board kind of thing to describe. So yes. So let's
the original Cycla or import Cycla?
Sorry?
The Cycla. So the invoke proxy, is that yours or is that Istio
service? Ah, no, no, it's through the Istio service.
It's only Cycla.
Istio. So actually there are two ways you can bring API management solution into the picture. So one way is there's no this kind of integration with your microservices, right? So you have all the APIs and you directly expose those APIs to the outside. So again, we have this API management requirement. So in that case, we front API manager and the API gateway front. So all the API requests will go through that gateway, right? So then this API manager component will come here and it will create another layer from there. And all the requests will go through there. And the subscription and everything handled in this place. So we are not going to use anyway, the request will go through the ingress gate and anything, but the API management part will happen in this layer. So that's the one way to do that thing. And the second way is, yes, we are going to use the existing ingress gateway, but only the management part will be done in the this layer. Thanks for bringing that question. I answered your question, right? Good, thanks. Okay, I'll do a quick demo on that thing. First, I'll deploy the WS2 API Manager Analytics component. Then I'll create the relevant config maps for the API Management Analytics and API Manager component. Now I'm going to deploy the WCP API manager. So let's deploy it. So you can see here I'll expose the API manager as a notepad, sorry. So I'll use this notepad to access this. So I have created a host entry for the IP address. So I'll going to invoke the API publisher first. I'll access the API publisher. And try to create an API for that thing. So I'll create a new API and publish it. This is the API manager publisher view. I think this is to the screen, it will go here and there things. So I'll create a new API first. Now I am going to create an API for the HTTP bin API that we have already exposed, and here we'll create and publish. So then it will go to the API store, so anyone can come to the store and discover the service and subscribe to that and invoke that. So I'll create a new API. So if you have a Sagger file or something, you can upload it and create and from the scratch also you can create. So I'll go to create it from the scratch. Okay, I need a name. Then I can version this API. Then I have to give the endpoint, so we can define who can access this thing, whether this should be visible to the public or not. Likewise, this is our API management related functionalities. So I'll going to publish that. So if you can add, before that thing, I have to define the paths relevant. So one is the IP. I'll add get. Yeah, these are the paths supported by my sample API. Then I going to save it. Then I have to set the production endpoint. So I have to set the API endpoint with there are a lot of capabilities in the API manager, API publisher, so I'm not going to discuss more about these capabilities. So if you like, you can go through this product and verify those capabilities. So when you publish, we can define the subscription levels. So these are the basic capabilities. So here I'll put unlimited, so there's no, I don't configure other tiers, so anyone can subscribe to this one and consume any number of API code. And the most important thing is now we can secure this API. So here we are going to use the O2.O to secure that thing. So I'll discuss the I'll configure the relevant scopes, and here scopes are validated against the role. So I'll bind a scope into the roles. I'll say I'll say only the users in the admin role only can get the scope called scope IP. So other users, if they are in a different role, they won't be able to get scope IP. So that validation will be happen when you try to get the access token. So I'll add this scope and I'll add another scope for the header API. Thank you.
So here I'll use the same API key as a scope name asset. So you can use different scope names, so you can fit different roles. So if you try, you can do different things. So I have added a scope. So I'll bind those scopes with relevant API. Yes, so to get the IP, we need to have the scope IP. To get the headers, we should have scope headers. Now I'm going to publish it. So once I publish it, it will publish the API, so I can go to the API store and see. At the same time, it will create a policy and it will push into the mixture. You can see this is the API store view. You can see the published API. So here I'll create a public API. So even without logging into the store, I can see this API. So now I log into the system. Before try to subscribe and invoke the API, now this API is secured. So let's try to invoke that API without these tokens or anything and see how the response comes. You can see previously with just invoking the API, we were able to get the response. Now let's see if we can get it now up. Something intro. Sorry, I think I didn't deploy the mixer adapter and other stuff. Let me do it. Which means even though I said it pushed the policies to the mixer adapter, I haven't deployed the mixer adapter, it means it might not have created. So I'll delete the API and deploy the mixture adapter and create the API again. So if you see this picture, so when I create the API, it need to publish the policies to the mixer. So it will directly talk to the adapter, and through the adapter, I will publish the policies to the mixer. But since I haven't deployed the adapter, even if I create the APIs, it can't publish those information to the adapter. So now I quickly create that API. I'll take the window to this machine and create it. Now you can see we are getting the error that missing credential. So now we have to get a token if you want to access this API. So let's subscribe to that API and get a token and invoke this API. So first I try to get a JWT token from here and invoke that thing. So now I don't going to mention any scope, and I'll just generate the token. So I'll copy that thing. Now we are getting still unauthorized because I didn't specify any scope. So let's see this JWT token first. Here you can see as the scope I am getting only the default scope. I didn't get scope IP or scope header. Let's get a new token with scope header. I think I didn't do the subscription for that API. Yes, for the JWT application, I didn't subscribe. So the third one, there I have subscribed to that thing. Anyhow, then I can't access that API. So I'll get a new key. Now with the scope of IP, and I'll get a token. I'll copy this. So you see, first I try to invoke the header API. Here I'll try to access the header API with the JWT token. So I didn't get chance to access, but IP API could, because if you remember when I mentioned the scope, I said configure only the scope IP. So with that JWT, I can't invoke the header API. I can only invoke the IP API. So in the similar way, we can get a normal bearer token and access the API. So I am not going to demo that thing, but I'll discuss how it works only. In the JWT scenario, so when we pass the JWT, it will go to the mixer and see whether there's applicable API. Then since we have applied policy, it try to validate the token. So if we pass a JWT, then there's no need to talk to the API manager to do the validation, even though API manager provide the key management capabilities and API subscription. Because since we are using the JWT token, we can verify that token validating the signature. So I didn't show you in the initially when we deploy, I'll get the key from the API manager and push it into the mixture. So there it will validate the signature, and it do validate that it does validate that scopes as well, scope and other relevant parameter validated there. If it's a valid token, it will let the API go into the service. So when it come to the this is what happened in the scope and JWT validation. If it didn't use the correct scopes, it didn't allow me to go inside. So I had to use the correct scopes. So then if it's a normal bearer token, what it happened is it will go to the API mixer, then it need to talk to the authorization server and see whether this token is valid or not. So it will talk to the API manager and validate the token. If it's a valid token and if it has the relevant scope, it will let the code go into the service. So yeah, at the same way, this information will be published into the WSO2 API manager analytics. So from there you can see the dashboards as well. So this is how it works. It seems time is running really fast. Yeah, do you have any questions before that?
So,
yes.
So when you add JWT on top of it.
Sorry?
So NOI uses MTLS, right?
Yes, meetup.
By default?
Yes.
So when you added JWT on top of it, what happened to MTLS? Is it still there? Or?
No, in this scenario, I have disabled meetup TLS.
So if it was one pod talking to another pod, it is still with the token?
Yes, with the token. There are different ways. One is the you can secure the service-to-service communication with the mutual TLS.
Yes,
so then only the service will be authenticated. So if you use the JWT token at the service, at the same time, whatever the user who is trying to access the service, both can be validated.
So it can support two.
Yes. Yeah.
And also, like when you expose the service,
mm-hmm.
the IP that you got, that was from the ingress on the ingress?
Yes,
or is
yes.
it on EPM as
No, ingress.
On ingress.
Yeah. Because in this scenario, we are not using the API manager as a gateway,
so
only
so
the ingress gateway.
Management for
yes, yes. Part. If we deploy in the other way, it means
yeah.
with full gateway capabilities,
yeah.
then the API manager gateway will be used.
So behind this service,
mm-hmm.
since the authentication is on endpoint, and since it's the same pod, so you don't have to technically authenticate on the API itself. Envoy is doing the authentication, but
yes.
the application itself does not care for the user.
Yes, yes. So basically, kind of normal gateway also validate in that layer. So that happen, the same thing will be happening here. Okay, a bit about, I am not going that much talk about WSO2. So we are one of the open source vendor, and we have mainly three products. One is four products, API Manager, WSO2 Identity Server, and WSO2 Enterprise Integrator, and WSO2 Stream Processor. So those are mainly for the integration related technology. And we have offices all around the globe, and at the moment we have more than 550 employees, and all the products are open source. So this is just bit about WSO2. So do you have any other questions? Okay.